Thank you. I'll call Mr. Davis.
President, my question is to the Minister for Resources. Minister, the new gold rush in Victoria is providing great excitement in Victoria and around the world. Investors the world over want to do business in Victoria, and this is an old industry for Victoria, but they are worried about the lack of transparency and red tape in Victoria. And I ask therefore, Minister, why did the North Central Victorian Goldfields ground release take nearly 2 years to complete?
Minister Pulford.
Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Davis for his question and his apparent interest in the environment in which investment can occur in Victoria, given the uncertainty that he prefers to create and the company that he and his colleagues keep. The answers to Mr. Davis's question and his interest in this tender, in short, that this is a very detailed process with many steps along the way. That takes time to give thorough and due consideration to such a release. And I would add to that that there are elements of this that are matters that are commercial in confidence and therefore will sort of limit my comments to that. Other than to make some general reflections on Victoria's gold rush, and in doing so, congratulate Mr. O'Donoghue on his 15 years in this place and his final speech to us, but his reflections on the gold rush and the majesty and ambition for Victoria in the 1850s that has led us to be in this extraordinary chamber. The gold that has been developed in Victoria's history since the 1850s is around the same amount of gold as is thought to continue to be available, which is quite an extraordinary thing to contemplate. The release of this tender, finalisation of this tender process, is a very, very exciting next step. Albeit in another part of the state, but very much on the theme of Victoria's gold rush, I had the opportunity to visit the Stawell gold mine last Friday, to go underground and to see exactly how this work is done, but also to hear a bit from industry about their plans and their goals and their ambitions, but also their very deep commitment to working with traditional owners, local communities, and operating within a regulatory environment that takes absolutely seriously and has at its forefront in every step of the way rehabilitation and environmental protection.
Mr. Davis on a supplementary.
I don't think you've really answered the question, but leaving that aside, Minister, will you release the rationale for your announcement late last month on the two successful tenderers for the four ground release options?
Minister Pulford.
Thank you, President, and thank Mr. Davis for his further question. I won't be releasing further information, as is appropriate for a matter such as this. The role of the Minister is very much at arm's length from the process. For those that have an interest in this process, there is publicly available information on ERR's website, and I would encourage people to familiarise themselves with what is public. Those things that aren't public are part of that commercial in confidence tender process and will remain confidential.
Mr. Quilty.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Police. The Licensing and Regulation Division, LRD, of Victoria Police manages Victoria's Firearms Registry. The Firearms Registry has a single purpose. To keep track of firearms, its job is literally to not lose firearms. Despite that, LRD has somehow managed to lose track of 100,000 firearms. There's also a litany of other record-keeping mistakes. This, as you can imagine, causes serious problems. If you turn in, destroy, or sell a firearm, and the government fails to update the record, they'll think you have a firearm when you do not. They could charge you with illegally owning these firearms or the legally disposing of them, and you'd be put in a position where you'd have to somehow demonstrate the government made the mistake. Or the opposite happens. Someone has firearms, but the record is lost, deleted, or edited incorrectly, calling the entire purpose of the registry into question. Minister, have you or will you commission an audit into the reasons these firearms are missing?
Minister Thiene.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Quilty for his question to the Minister for Police. I'll refer that matter to her, and I'm sure that she will respond as per the standing orders.
Mr. Quilty on a supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. It's not just bad record keeping or firearms that owners lose. Confiscated weapons frequently go missing. An audit of a gun store confiscation showed the police seized and then lost 81 firearms. In another case, a security business owner reports possessing 16 firearms that LRD records show are in police possession. Police appear to have no idea where firearms are, even when those firearms are held by the police. When they aren't busy losing firearms, LRD is busy telling criminals where they can find them. In 2017, the personal details of 9,000 firearms owners were released via email. And there is a widely held view amongst law-abiding firearm owners that sources within LRD are providing information to criminal organisations. I am told there's little or no control over who within LRD accesses records or why. If records were being deliberately leaked, there's no internal process to catch it. Minister, what are you doing to address these failures of the Firearms Registry and of the Licensing and Regulation Division?
Thank you, President. I will refer this to the Minister for Police in terms of an answer to the question that's being posed, but I will also refer the very serious allegations that are embedded in the supplementary question that you have submitted today.
Mr. Statement, Minister Pulford.
Thank you, President. Very pleased to update the House on the Victorian Government's submission to the 2021 Regional Telecommunications Review, which takes place every 3 years and is all about reviewing connectivity services in regional, rural and remote parts of Australia. We welcome the opportunity to advocate for better connectivity for our regional and rural communities. The Andrews Labor Government is committed to improving connectivity for Victorians no matter where they live, and that's why we're calling for the Commonwealth Government to give people in regional and rural Australia better access to vital telecommunications, especially during emergencies. In our submission, we call on the Commonwealth Government and the telecommunications industry to work together to ensure people can access multiple mobile providers during emergencies such as natural disasters. Over the past 2 years, Victoria has experienced devastating emergencies such as bushfires and storms. We're advocating for change because we know firsthand how important it is for people to be connected to loved ones and information during a crisis, something that has become more common as we are living with an increasingly erratic and changing climate. We are calling for the Commonwealth to make this happen as it must be led at a national level. Our position is a solution for mobile emergency roaming to improve access to communications and services during emergencies and better support community safety to be implemented. People can always call 000 regardless of which provider they're with. This type of connectivity could be extended to other mobile and broadband services during emergencies, and people could also call emergency services or loved ones, check websites and receive alerts from whichever network is available. In the meantime, we're helping improve mobile and broadband coverage in Victoria by fast-tracking connectivity across the state through our $550 million Connecting Victoria program. The program has involved consultation with many Victorians to learn more about mobile and broadband connectivity gaps and challenges they are experiencing. People told us consistently that mobile coverage during emergencies is a critical issue. Victorian Government's submission to the 2021 Regional Telecommunications Review is available online on the Regional Telecommunications Review website, should members wish to familiarise themselves with it.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.
President, my question is for the Minister for Employment. Victoria has become the most unemployed state in the nation due to the devastation wrought by this government's lockdowns, the longest in the world. ABS data released last week shows that Victoria has lost roughly the equivalent of the population of Shepparton or Mildura of employed people over recent weeks. Over the period of the survey, over 49,000 Victorian jobs were lost. Furthermore, existing casual and part-time workers continue to lose as more than 1 in 10 want more hours but cannot get them, the highest rate in the nation. So, Minister, isn't it a fact that what you are doing is actually not working and you need to take serious steps to fix the problems that your government is creating?
is from a bloke who goes to rallies with the noose people and comes and talks to us about a safe business operating environment.
Order.
I mean, you are a clown.
Order, Minister.
You're a liar.
Please.
You're a liar and a fool. You're a liar. That is not true.
Thank you. Mr. Davis, on a point of order.
President, it's a very serious question about unemployment. The Minister may want to make snide comments in some way, but actually, I didn't actually go to that, but I did not.
Thank you.
But President, it's a serious question about unemployment. If the Minister for Employment does not want to answer it, that is a problem.
Minister, please.
Thank you. I'm very keen to answer this question because we are absolutely determined to provide an open economy where businesses are trading, where they are re-engaging people, where those hours are increasing, and everything you people have been doing runs counter to that objective. So earlier today, the Premier, the Health Minister, the Acting Chief Health Officer announced the next step in the roadmap, which will kick in at midnight tonight, right? No thanks to you people at all, absolutely none, right? So the unemployment data that was released last week reflects the reality of the circumstances Victorians have been living with. But it is, I think, important. Oh, yeah, without, like, pandemic creation superpower. Like, what sort of lunatic are you? You are an...
Thank you. Thank you. Minister.
And Mr. Davis and his mates, including those outrageous, violent, racist people with whom the Liberal Party have been consorting, are very keen.
Order.
Are very
order,
keen
Minister.
To create.
Minister, order.
President, Ms. Pulford is very agitated today. We understand why, because the government stuffed up this pandemic legislation. However, calling, saying, I will ask you to ask Ms. Pulford to withdraw that last comment in relation to the Liberal Party and a number of people that have been out in the front that she is associating everybody with. That is not in order, and I'd ask you to withdraw, ask Ms. Pulford to withdraw those ridiculous comments.
Mr. Jeff.
Thank you, President. To the point of order, it is fact that Mr. Davis and a number of Liberal Party members from this chamber and the other chamber have been out the front with those people who are perpetrating violence and threatening members of this place and their families and their staff, and it is quite appropriate for Minister Pulford to draw the Chamber's attention to that. There is no point of order from Ms. Crozier, and she shouldn't have to withdraw
Thank
anything.
You. Thank you. Oh, Mr. Finn.
I can assure you, Mr. President, I can assure the House that I have absolutely no involvement with anybody who has been in any violence at all. In fact, when I was out there the other day, it was more like a party than anything else.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Member.
No,
well, Mr.
Just telling the truth.
Thank you. Thank you.
You wouldn't be used to it, would you?
Mr. Jeb, thank you. On the point of order, and on your explanation, Mr. Finn, as well, the Minister didn't name anyone. But at the same time, I will ask Minister to concentrate on the question, not on the rally. Minister.
Thank you. The business environment in which Victorian businesses operate and provide employment to people is highly relevant, and that is why we have been seeking to ensure that businesses are supported, that people are supported through record investments in employment programs. If the Liberal Party spent more time with the business community and less time with people that, you know, aren't the business community, they would know the single biggest issue facing Victorian businesses is a workforce and skills shortage. Right?
Lockdowns. Don't forget lockdowns. That's an impact too.
And the Liberal Liberal Party keep telling people there will be lockdowns when all of the evidence suggests otherwise? And indeed, the roadmap announcement today suggests otherwise. And indeed, the roadmap announcements for months, right? So you go tell people there'll be lockdowns, but we're interested in working with the business community, with working with employment service providers to support people into work who, through no fault of their own, have found their hours reduced or their employment reduced. Now, I would also make the point that the unemployment rate is currently lower than it was this time last year as we were coming out of last winter's lockdown. It is lower than when we came to government. So it has been an incredibly challenging period for people, but we are making record investments. We have all sorts of programs and initiatives by industry sector, by geographical region, to ensure that this recovery is as inclusive for people as possible. Wherever we can, we promote secure and ongoing employment. And to suggest the Liberal Party give two hoots about anyone out of work is absurd.
Mr. Davis on a supplementary.
Well, President, the very strange response by the Minister, but let me just say, she is right to say these people have lost their jobs through no fault of their own. In fact, it's the government's fault in significant measure. And I say that 113,000 fewer Victorians are in work or actively seeking a job over the last 6 months, as Victoria remains the only state with negative population growth. Minister, isn't it a fact that the Andrews government is objectively the worst performing government in the nation?
Minister.
No. No, it's not. And our government has sought to ensure the safety of the Victorian community, the protection of jobs, the creation of jobs, and all you people have done the whole time is undermine our every effort to do so, including as recently as Tuesday, as recently as today, on multiple occasions. In fact, the last division in this chamber, you were seeking to have a situation where people are looking for jobs in Victoria and businesses are seeking to trade in Victoria where there is no mechanism to manage the pandemic.
Order, Minister.
What a reckless...
Minister.
The bill that was there, but let me be quite clear, that bill was her lockdown bill, a lockdown bill to close the state down further.
Order. Ms. Stepser on a point of order.
President, there are two issues I want to raise. Mr. Davis again aggressively pointing in this chamber, and I ask that he cease that aggressively pointing.
All right, thank you.
And he cannot direct the minister how to answer the question. He might not like the answer, but bad luck.
Whilst accusing me of aggressively pointing, the member actually aggressively pointed herself.
Okay, thank you. You finished? All right. Thank you, Minister, to come back to answer. Thank you. And please, respect.
So businesses are open and trading and they're doing it safely and people are entering those places safely and there is an enormous demand for people to meet the jobs needs of those organisations. And we are working with industry to help them find people into work. We're working with people who, through their own personal circumstances, may have never worked before to meet what is a very significant demand for people in work.
Thank you, Minister. Fine. Mr. Hayes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Let's all stay calm for my questioner. It's not too stirring, I don't think, but we'll see how we go, eh? Earlier this year, a motion initiated by me was passed in this chamber, which asked the Victorian Government to publicly urge the federal government to strengthen laws against money laundering in property transactions in order to
defend... Sorry, Mr. Hayes, who are you addressing your question to?
To the Minister representing the Premier.
Thank you.
We're up. Strengthen laws against money laundering in property transactions in order to defend the rule of law and tackle financial crime. My question is, what has the Premier done to call on the federal government to crack down on this problem?
Mr. Syme.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Hayes for his question and his calming influence on this chamber. I will pass your question on to the Premier and provide a response in accordance with the standing order.
Mr. Mr. Hayes on a supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Attorney. Thank you for your calming answer. My supplementary is, recent media reports show that gangs have laundered billions of dollars via the property market, with AUSTRAC estimating $1 billion alone in 2020 and the AFP seizing $116 million in real estate assets in 2021. Along with the Crown Casino money laundering and other reported cases, such as the $62 million criminal operation that was uncovered last month in Melbourne, in what was declared to be one of the largest money washing syndicates uncovered in Australia, it's not fanciful to say we have some serious criminal conduct being uncovered in Victoria. Will the Premier please inform us how the state is to collaborate with AUSTRAC, financial industry partners and law enforcement to stop this criminal exploitation of the financial system?
Symes.
Yeah. Thank you, President, and I will also pass Mr. Hayes a supplementary question on to the Premier, and there might be a bit of crossover. We'll see what sort of answer we can produce for you.
Mr. Statement, Minister Tini.
President, I rise to update the Chamber on the progress of Kangan TAFE's new Health and Community Centre of Excellence in Broadmeadows. I am incredibly proud that the Andrews Labor Government is investing $60 million to deliver a better TAFE campus in Broadmeadows. It is such an important project. We know that the health sector is growing and needs additional pipeline of skilled workers. And we know that Kangan TAFE is a critical provider of health training in Melbourne's north. This facility will mean more local students getting the local skills that they need for local jobs, including at Northern Health. This week, we reached the next stage in making this project a reality. I was pleased to announce that Architectus has been appointed to design the new facility. The facilities will include laboratories, flexible learning spaces and outdoor recreation facilities, facilities for students in areas such as nursing, mental health, pathology, disability and aged care. I can't wait to see the designs of this magnificent facility. Construction will begin in early 2023 and will create 300 local trade jobs. President, Broadmeadows is a proud community, a community that knows how important their local TAFE is, and this community deserves a world-class TAFE campus. Only a Labor government would ever deliver this project, and that's exactly what we're doing, President.
Yeah. Dr. Barr.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, President. My question is to the Attorney General. Attorney, you were asked a few days ago whether you would cooperate with an investigation into the red shirt rorts were it to be reopened. Your response, reported in the media, was qualified. You said that, as first law officer of our state, you would judge any request from the police to cooperate, and I quote, on its merits. Attorney, are you above the law?
Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Bark for his question and the opportunity to respond. I think in terms of the way you have framed the question, that's not my recollection of exactly the order of questions and answering, but I understand what you're trying to ask. I was asked a hypothetical question about whether I would cooperate with police if asked. It's a complex question in a hypothetical situation because as a lawyer, as someone that has been asked to give legal advice to people in the past, I would always advise anybody who was approached by police to come and have a chat, anybody who was arrested by police to seek legal advice and to follow that legal advice or at least consider their options in the context of receiving legal advice. So it was a very difficult question to answer in a hypothetical sense because it wasn't a situation that I could respond to having had any experience.
Dr. Barcher on the supplementary.
Thank you, President. I do thank the attorney for her response. I understand your response. I do thank you for it. When questioned by police, however, isn't it the duty of all members of Parliament, but in particular the first law officer of our state, to both cooperate and also to tell the truth?
Well, I think that's the thing. It's a question that you are putting to me without any basis. In a general sense, I would encourage everybody to cooperate in with any legal authority that they're asked to, but that doesn't mean that you don't have rights. Although I believe that members of parliament should have the highest standards in our community, that doesn't mean we don't have the same rights as everybody else in the community. So, of course, police inquiries, police investigations, I would seek to cooperate, but I wouldn't give away my rights not to seek legal advice and consider what options I had in that regard. But again, the questions you are asking me, I don't have any practical experience to draw on. So I am trying to answer your question by answering in the same way if somebody asked me about if they were in a position where they were asked to speak to police, I would always say you should seek legal advice.
Thank you, Mr. Barton.
Thank you, President. My question today is for Minister Pulford, representing Minister Carroll. Some of you may be aware of an article in yesterday's Sydney Morning Herald titled, "Every Day Two Sexual Assault or Misconduct Complaints Hit Uber." An audit of the New South Wales Point-to-Point Transport Commissioner that in New South Wales alone, Uber had 516 complaints of sexual misconduct and assault in a six-month period, almost three a day. In 94% of the sexual misconduct complaints, Uber let their drivers stay on their platform. In fact, drivers stayed on the road even after multiple complaints, including one who was offering free rides in exchange for sex. This is disgusting, vile and abhorrent behaviour. So given that New South Wales Uber is receiving an average of almost three reports of sexual assault and misconduct a day, my question is, how many notifiable incidents have been reported by Uber to the CPVV in the past year?
Mr. Pulford.
And for his question, I did see the article that he refers to and some very concerning observations made in that article. I will seek a written response from Minister Carroll for you.
Mr. Barton on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Minister. Currently, the public do not have access to the notifiable incidents reported by different market players in the commercial passenger vehicle market. It is my view that the Victorian public is entitled to this information. In New South Wales, these statistics are publicly available. If a market player is reporting a large number of sexual assault and misconduct complaints, the public should be aware of it. If the market player is allowing drivers who have been reported for sexual assault to continue to service the public on that platform, the public should be aware of that. If the lack of safety requirements, such as no tamper-proof cameras or GPS tracking, has led to one sector of the market experience higher rates of sexual assault and misconduct, the public should be aware of that. So my supplementary is, will the Minister make these notifiable incidents be published online to ensure public transparency and accountability?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Barton for his supplementary question and interest in this matter, and I'll seek a written response to that from Minister Carroll as well.
Minister's statement, Minister Steed.
Thank you, President. Silicosis is a catastrophic, debilitating lung disease that has already cost too many workers their health and, in some cases, their lives. We know that people who work with engineered stone, commonly used for kitchen benchtops, are at risk of exposure to silica dust, which can lead to deadly lung and respiratory diseases, including silicosis. Since the start of 2021, four workers have tragically died from silica-related illness, and WorkSafe has accepted 59 claims for silica-related diseases. These tragedies remind us why the Andrews Labor government has taken action to ban the dry cutting of engineered stone and are rolling out greater protections for workers. This week, the government has further strengthened those protections by launching Australia's first licensing scheme for businesses working with engineered stone. The changes are backed by rigorous auditing and compliance activities and mean that Victorian employers will be required to prove compliance with safety measures to obtain a licence to work with engineered stone. And because awareness plays such a crucial role in preventing occupational hazards, the changes will require businesses to provide information to job applicants about the health risks associated with silica dust, while also ensuring that their employees are given adequate training to control these risks. And I note the large number of cold workers in this industry and the need to make sure they understand the hazards. Yeah.
These changes build on the government's action to reduce silica-related disease, which includes an enforcement blitz and free silica health screenings that more than 1,300 past and present stonemasons have registered for through WorkSafe and the Alfred Occupational Respiratory Clinic. The Andrews Labor government is committed to tough action on the use of engineered stone, and we will continue to act to protect workers from this deadly disease, President.
Thank you, Ms. Barth.
Thank you, President. President, my question is to the Attorney. The inquiry report into animal activism was handed down 21 months ago, and recommendation 5 from that report outlined the need for on-the-spot fines. As Victoria's top lawmaker, why hasn't legislation been introduced to give farmers protection against extreme animal rights activists who trespass on farmers' homes, on their businesses, and breach biosecurity?
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Barth for her question and her ongoing advocacy in relation to farmers and people in her electorate. Of course, when the inquiry motion was put to this chamber, it was the government that sought to expand that motion to make sure that the committee had a full range of terms of reference to consider all of these important issues. As the previous Minister for Agriculture, I am on the record of condemning such behaviour, entering people's farms, which is very regularly their home, in the name of animal activism and causing fear and concern to those farmers is completely inappropriate, and there are other ways to demonstrate your objection to certain things. And I've also, in my previous role, worked with the VFF and others in encouraging greater community awareness about the wonderful work our farmers do. They are the caretakers of the land and and champions of animal welfare in many regards. In relation to your question, Ms. Barth, it's a common misconception that as the Attorney-General I'm responsible for every law that comes into fruition and comes through the Parliament. Just ask my family. I get asked about road laws and things like that a lot. I do not have responsibility for every law that comes into the Parliament, and I do understand that the question that you asked was a similar question put to the relevant minister, the Minister for Agriculture, who has carriage of delivering the responding to the recommendations in that report. Of course, any crossover with the Department of Justice in relation to consideration of laws and how they may interact with pieces of legislation that I am responsible for, those conversations are indeed and have been happening, and I will leave announcements in relation to delivery of this commitment to the relevant minister, the Minister for Agriculture.
Ms. Barth on a supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for her response. Being safe in our homes, in our businesses, on our farms that are also our homes for farmers are it's a very important issue that needs to be addressed. It has been 21 months and indeed approximately around 18 months since the government's response to this report supported that recommendation. When can the government give an assurity that this will actually be introduced and farmers can have on-the-spot fines to create that additional safety barrier for their homes and their families?
Thank you, Ms. Barth, and I do thank you in your supplementary question for effectively paraphrasing my answer that I gave in relation to my agreement with you in relation to the farmers' rights and the fact that many of them, their homes is their workplace and they deserve protection. But I've already answered your supplementary question by telling you that I am not the relevant minister, and although I'm interested in the legislation that all ministers bring to the chamber to deliver on important reforms, representing and providing benefits to the Victorian people, it's not my job to inform you when another minister's legislation will be coming forth.
Dr. Adnam.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Planning. I've recently been contacted by residents living in buildings affected by the flammable cladding crisis who are concerned about the rollout of the cladding rectification program. Residents are reporting a significant delay between receiving a risk assessment reading from the VBA and receiving any timelines or funding commitments from Cladding Safety Victoria. I've heard that councils are now enforcing building orders on affected buildings and pushing owners to to begin rectification works despite owners not receiving any CSV funding for the expensive rectification, remembering that rectification is required because of failures of building regulation. Residents are concerned that CSV is stalling because they no longer have enough funding to cover the promised rectification works, and that residents may end up having to cover the works themselves. Minister, has the CSV got enough funding remaining to cover rectification works for all buildings that need it?
Minister Steed.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Ratnam, for your question, and I'd be very happy to refer that matter to the Minister for Planning for a detailed answer.
Dr. Ratnam on a supplementary.
Thank you very much, Minister. I appreciate that follow-up. And a supplementary question, if owners do follow council orders and arrange for the works themselves, I've heard they will be unable to seek subsequent reimbursement through CSV as there are strict rules relating to retrospective funding. This forces residents to choose between living in dangerous conditions or being thousands of dollars out of pocket. Minister, will there be additional funding allocated to allow CSV to issue retrospective funding for works carried out by owners?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I will also refer Dr. Ratnam's supplementary question to Minister Wynne for a response.
Thank you. Minister Statement, Minister Lean.
Thank you, President. Today I'd like to update the House on the Government's Suburban Revitalisation Program in Melton. $640,000 being invested into Melton through the Government Suburban Development Revitalisation Program. The Melton Revitalisation Board has been working closely with the City of Melbourne on new projects that will engage the Melton's youth and support local businesses. Here's some of the great projects. Streetscape improvement works along High Street and Mackenzie Street. The Melton Town Hall Employment Centre Employment Program, a partnership between YLAB, ArcBlue and Job Perspectives to design policies related to recruitment and training of young people in local businesses. The Shopfront Improvement Program engaging a retail specialist to work with traders to provide practical advice and support and facilitate improvement of shop fronts. The Improvement Accessibility Project audits up to 50 local traders to highlight opportunities to improve accessibility in their businesses. A community planning proposal to deliver various initiatives in the local area, ranging from pop-up events, school holiday programs, and handy community tools such as interactive maps. Across the metropolitan area, the Suburban Revitalisation Program has invested $25 million to deliver similar projects with similar partnerships. And can I thank the Revitalisation Board? And I'd just like to acknowledge the Chair. The Member for Melton, Mr. McGee. What a fantastic member for Melton he is. Well, the change he has made to Melton. An ex-paramedic, and it's good to have varying skills in, you know. We actually have all sorts of different skills. We have trade people. We have paramedics. We have lawyers. Yes, we have lawyers.
Thank you. That concludes question and answers.